And we are back with Glenn Hubbard, Senior Economic Advisor to Governor Romney. You've talked a lot, Governor Romney has, about the uncertainty, the climate of uncertainty that makes it difficult for businesses to invest. I can't imagine something that would be more uncertain than this issue of the debt ceiling. Do you believe that John Boehner and the House Republicans should make it clear that the United States will not default on its debt?
Well, first, the United States is not going to default on its debt. We have a witching hour where the debt ceiling, budget sequestrations, and the so-called fiscal cliff and tax rates are all occurring, and that will be part of a political negotiation. As an economist, I would think that if we get to a situation where Governor Romney becomes the president, then the lame duck Congress ought to simply shift things down the road a few months to the enactment of Governor Romney's tax plan. If the president wins re-election, that's a different negotiation, but it should center quickly on the appropriate tax policy. But there's no question that the nation isn't going to default on its debt.
But should we make that clear to prevent uncertainty? Should John Boehner make clear that the United States will not default?
I can't give political advice to politicians. All I can say is the real economic issue here is both addressing the size of spending and then how you want to deal with the fiscal cliff.
Obamacare. This is a subject you know a lot about. You wrote a book about fixing healthcare. When I look at the problem, it does seem as though if you have an insurance-based system and you don't include everyone, you end up in a kind of negative spiral for insurance companies where they're trying to kick people off with pre-existing conditions because they don't want to just have sick people on. That is the reason that Governor Romney of Massachusetts decided you had to have a mandate. Doesn't it make sense then to preserve the individual mandate in Obamacare, because that's what makes an insurance system work, that you have healthy and unhealthy people in it?
No, I don't think so, Fareed. First of all, you have to start with what's the goal of the reform? And I think from an economic perspective, the goal of healthcare reform is to slow the rate of growth of healthcare costs to make both healthcare and health insurance more affordable. That in turn increases coverage. You don't need an individual mandate to do that, but you do need to help markets work better. And you identified some of the problems. You really do have to go after pre-existing conditions. You have to make sure that the chronically ill are taken care of in a way that doesn't hurt the functioning of private insurance markets. You have to change insurance regulation to make it possible to buy cheaper policies. If you do those things and you fix the tax bias against many ways of purchasing health insurance and health care, you can go a very, very long way toward cost reductions. That's really what a market-oriented health care reform is about, and you don't need the individual mandate to do any of
that. So was Governor Romney wrong to do it in Massachusetts? Because the philosophy behind it is exactly the philosophy behind Obamacare.
No, what Governor Romney was doing in Massachusetts was taking a particular set of state circumstances and a particular...
Which is the same, which is that you don't have the young healthy weren't buying insurance, and that was kind of screwing up the insurance system.
What he has said is that individual states may do all kinds of experimentations.
But that
doesn't follow from that a national mandate makes
sense. Well,
that
only makes sense logically if you say the Massachusetts example then was a failure. Was the Massachusetts... Was Romney Care a failure? Because if it's a success, of course, the federal government should adopt it.
I don't think you can say that. Again, it goes back to the question that you're trying to answer. Is the goal lowering health care costs? Is it increasing the number of insured individuals? I think all of those things that are in the mix. So I don't think you can draw the link between Massachusetts and the national system. I think what's on offer for the American people to decide is effectively Obamacare that would double down on all the flaws that I mentioned, all the flawed insurance markets, all the flawed tax system, or a more market-oriented healthcare system. That's really what's on offer.
What is the central focus of the Romney economic plan? How would you describe it?
Listen to the devil talk.
I would say it's really single-mindedly focused on two things and an important byproduct. The two things are, how do we get economic growth back to what this country is capable of? And second, how do we make that growth inclusive so that all Americans see the benefits of it? The key byproduct of that will be job creation when people see that America is a country in which you should want to invest, whether you're an American saver and investor or a foreign saver and investor. It's really that simple.
I had Paul Krugman, the economist, on recently, and I asked him what he thought of Governor Romney's plan. And he said Governor Romney's plan, as I understand it, is we need to cut government spending substantially to restore confidence in the markets. What he should look at is the experience of Europe, where they have cut government spending. As a result, their economies are in a tailspin. Their budget deficits are widening. Their debt is growing, because by cutting spending, you are in effect reducing demand, destroying the economy in a weak economic climate. And that it to him is bizarre that, given this evidence that Europe provides of countries from Spain to Britain, that they've cut spending and it hasn't worked, why should you adopt austerity-type programs in the United States?
It is unfortunate, I think, in Europe, and to a lesser extent even in the United States, that policymakers define austerity as being about this year's budget. The real problem, particularly in the American setting, is how do we get the budget on a glide path towards sustainability? So in the U.S. Case, to be concrete, how do we change and slow the rate of growth of entitlements in the long run? How do we gradually reduce discretionary spending? All the things we were talking about before. If we do that right, we don't have to have such dramatic austerity this year. That's a valid point. But it is not a valid point to say that the act of austerity is growth diminishing. The question is whether it's forward-looking, like getting government on the right path, or just budget cutting this year. That's really the question.
But that suggests you would be comfortable with a, you know, much longer-term plan where you would tolerate large deficits for a while as long as there was this long plan. And I would suggest to you the Tea Party will not be happy to hear that.
Well, and that's not what Governor Romney's proposed. If we can get federal spending to 20% of GDP by 2016, the deficit will be very small. A healthy tax system and a healthy economy would produce 18-19% of GDP in revenue. So those won't be large deficits. The very big deficits that the country should be very afraid of are the deficits that are coming in the next decade and the decade after that. And there we do have time for gradual adjustment. But no, we shouldn't tolerate enormous deficits today. My point is we simply don't have to make huge changes in our entitlement programs today. We can do those gradually. We do have time. But we don't have time if we wait four more years.
Glenn Hubbard, pleasure to have you on.
My pleasure.
When we come back, why China has a problem with America's human rights record.